how y'all doing? This is Mongo Slade, and today we're going to talk about Drew McIntyre and AJ Styles. Plus Miz and Morrison, because for the fourth week straight, it feels like Miz and Morrison start Raw with a silly, silly segment. This was an episode of The Dirt Sheet that featured Miz reading a story, which rhymed, a rhyming story, a play, if you will, featuring AJ Styles reenacting acting out a fight with William Wallace, played by John Morrison, though he was, of course, supposed to be Drew McIntyre. So this was an absolutely silly segment that actually I hated it at first, and then my cable cut off, so I had to watch it again. So I watched it back. I actually liked it the second time because I actually started listening to what they were saying as far as the rhyming and everything. And John Morrison was great. He was absolutely great. He's talking about me back, me head. It was so dumb. It was so dumb. It was crazy as hell, man. But the general idea, of course, is AJ Styles is going to slay Drew McIntyre, stab him with a sword, or some such nonsense. And I can't believe he said me back. Me head. Oh. I don't even know if they talk like that in Scotland, but I know it was funny. But ultimately, I remain sick of Morrison and Miz being silly. But let's go into this. So Sheamus came out there and kind of broke up this game that they were playing. And Sheamus was like, hey, he's ready to have the match. It's supposed to be Sheamus versus AJ Styles. It was kind of, you know, messing around, and Styles said, okay, look, we don't have to do this. You could be part of the solution, not part of the problem. And Sheamus wanted to be part of the problem. So AJ Styles throws a Christmas tree at Sheamus. It just got weirder and weirder as the night went on. You had people throwing Christmas trees. You had a guy setting some guy on fire. It was what a show. What a show. WWE, man. What can you do? Anyway, after he threw this Christmas tree at Sheamus, he of course got out of the ring screaming, "Got him!" And then Sheamus threw a box at AJ Styles, which bounced off his head. We went to commercial. And when we came back from the commercial, they had the match. Now, the match was, was slower paced, a lot slower than they would usually work. There was a little, kind of no sense of urgency, but they were kind of building a story. I like that almost, protected Styles, grabbing them, as Sheamus about to powerbomb him through the floor, not through the floor, but through the announce table. There was a stare down between Almost and Sheamus. They kind of wanted to get, like, Sheamus is a big dude. I don't know how tall, I think Sheamus is 6'4", maybe. And Almost is way bigger than he is. So I like that. I like the, I think that's the second or third time Almost has kind of backed Sheamus down. But that little staring thing between the two of them was pretty interesting. Now, the story really picked up in the match when AJ Styles started working the leg. So, so he started, doing the general leg submissions, sitting on the leg on the, as the leg was bridged over the bottom rope. Calf crusher, that kind of thing. And it was actually looking pretty good. It was a pretty fun match. The finish came with AJ Styles slipping away from Sheamus while Sheamus was on the middle rope. He tripped him while he was on the rope. He fell backwards, and then Styles just pinned him. He didn't even put his feet on the ropes. So he didn't really cheat, but it almost helped him a little bit. And I liked what happened. I liked the post-match. Post-match was really fun. So we get Sheamus is barking, and he's still hurt. His legs are hurt. He's barking at, Styles. Styles gets within arm's reach, and Sheamus grabs Styles, and then Almost grabs Sheamus. And Sheamus is tied up in the ropes, because he's, falling into the second ropes. He's dangling out. It was a really precarious position. It was really strange how he got in it. And then Styles beat the shit out of him with the chair. Just beat this guy with this chair mercilessly. And Sheamus was defenseless. Like, we have never seen Sheamus this vulnerable. And I don't mean ever. Like, these last couple of weeks of Sheamus just getting beat, like, just pinned straight up, just getting mauled by various people, beat up, just... We have never seen Sheamus like this. Sheamus is usually very strong. Even as a babyface or a heel or whatever, he's usually pretty strong. In this situation, he looks almost completely out of his element. Like he's lost his edge. And, you know, Styles is beat the hell out of him. And what happens? Nothing. Drew McIntyre did not show up. Drew McIntyre, once again, did not come out to help Sheamus. Which, of course, did not go unnoticed. And so that was pretty interesting. And I like the Sheamus stuff. Because Sheamus came out there to take up for Drew McIntyre and to, you know, get this match started. But he's having a hard time here. He's having a real hard time because, you know, these little goobers, you know, Styles and Miz and Morrison, they keep getting the best of him. You know, he's trying to fight all these guys by himself, and he's not overcoming. So they're building the heat between Sheamus and McIntyre by McIntyre simply not being there for Sheamus, not wanting to help him. So I can almost see that Sheamus may, you know, have something to do with the title match because Almost is out there. Miz and Morrison have threatened to interfere in the title match too. So maybe we'll get Sheamus running to the ring. And maybe that's when we'll have Sheamus turn on McIntyre at TLC to cost McIntyre the title, maybe. But let's go through the rest of this show. So because Miz and Morrison are involved in the title picture, I have to fold him in here. Miz and Morrison have a match with Keith Lee. Is there any reason for this? Not really. Other than maybe because Keith Lee is friends with Drew McIntyre, even though we're kind of... It's not really driven home. It's like, yeah, they talked about it before, but they haven't talked about it in a while. Drew McIntyre also, you know, well, I can't say that because Keith Lee did kind of say that Sheamus was going to turn on Drew. And he can come out and help Sheamus either. But so it was weird. But I guess that's why Keith Lee is in this situation because he was also friends with Drew McIntyre. So... Keith Lee comes fresh from the PC. Apparently, I guess his skills are properly refined. In any event, he has this handicap match with Miz and Morrison. I don't know why this match is happening. I don't know why he couldn't just wrestle one of them. He had to wrestle both of them. And they didn't have to make tags. So the weird thing came before when he did the coin toss. So Keith Lee has a coin. For literally no reason. Now, Miz and Morrison, before this, Miz and Morrison are talking about AJ Styles. And Miz is not really feeling AJ Styles. He's actually going to, it feels like he's going to double cross him. That, you know, he's going to wait for, it did it in the play too, where the Miz kind of talked about cashing in on AJ Styles. And AJ Styles was like, you don't like that. He didn't like the sound of that. But Miz kind of teased it again here in this segment. That he might just have to cash in on AJ Styles because it might be easier to cash in on Styles than it would be to cash in on McIntyre. So then Keith Lee shows up with the coin and he does a coin flip. It literally is unexplained. He says, I have this coin. He says, you know, don't matter where I got it from. And the Miz and Morrison start shouting out heads and tails. And he flipped the coin. It was whatever it was. Miz and Morrison won. He said, this is the only thing you're going to win. I didn't know what any of that meant. None of that was explained. But Keith Lee was definitely talking different. His speech pattern, the way that he talked before the Professor Hulk Keith Lee, was kind of gone. He sounded pretty normal in this piece. So maybe part of it is like they're going to drop the way he talks, the overly verbose speech pattern. Which is fine. You know, it was different. But, you know, whatever. So I kept asking myself, why is this happening? Why are we having this match? And I never got an answer. So the match started and we get a Bruce Lee fight scene between Keith Lee and John Morrison. And it was Keith Lee throwing punches, John Morrison dodging, John Morrison trying to punch Lee running out of the way. It was the kind of useless, choreographed fight scene that you would see on the indies. I can tell you this is probably John Morrison's idea. I can just look at it and tell it looks like a John Morrison idea. Where, you know, Morrison is dodging back elbows. And it was highly choreographed. It looked really weird. Keith Lee was moving in slow motion to make sure that he didn't tear, you know, Morrison's head off. It's not what wrestling is supposed to be. It's like, I like Keith Lee. I do. I like John Morrison too. But I didn't like this. This whole kung fu shit that they got going on here. Say, I mean, look, I've seen Tony Jaa fight scenes that look better than that. Okay? And them shits look full contact. Like, if you ever seen a movie like The Raid, like, those movies are movies. But them shits look full contact. That shit like it hurts. I don't want to see the 1970s, what was that? The Five Deadly Venoms style fight scenes on Raw. I just don't want to see that. You know, where there's nowhere near any contact. And guys are just dodging it, whoosh, whoosh. It's like, come on, bro. We need to get out of that. I hate that people started doing that. You know, I think RVD and Jerry Lynn popularized that. It's the worst. Anyway, another botch was John Morrison was supposed to get pounced over the top rope, but he leaped a little bit before then because he was basically over the rope before Lee even got even close to him. I said this before, like, guys need to learn. Just take the hit, man. Just take the pounce and use your athleticism to propel yourself over the rope. It's just a shoulder tackle, man. That's all it is. It's not like you had to, you know, eat a full body clothesline. It was just a shoulder tackle. He was going over the ropes anyway. Use his body to bounce off of and go over the ropes. That's all you had to do, man. So the finish came with John Morrison and The Miz. John Morrison was about to do his disaster kick. Or I forget what he calls it, but I know that Cody calls it a disaster kick. But Keith Lee caught him. So then The Miz chop blocked Keith Lee. And then he was pinned as both men sat on him. Well, both men laid on him. And I am of the opinion that Keith Lee still could have got out of that. Now, you know, I'm not a mark for wins and losses, so I'm not upset that Keith Lee got pinned. I am not upset that he lost. It was the first time he ever lost a pinfall match, and it was two men at one time. And I say that, and I remain that two men should always beat one. But I did see other people was complaining, which, of course, they always complain. And it was weird, you know, because it really kind of made no sense. But it did seem like that there's going to be a harder edge to Keith Lee now. He seemed very aggressive. He seemed very intense. So I think they might be trying to turn him heel, or at least, you know, show that there's something brewing within him. But I'm not upset that he got pinned. I'm not upset. I didn't think that it was necessary, but I didn't see it as a big deal either. So for me, it was like, okay, well, it was just a weird thing to do on Raw to get his first pin out of the way and to give it to The Miz and Morrison. And I understand it because The Miz has the Money in the Bank and maybe you want to give Miz some type of momentum, but then they killed that momentum in just a few minutes. How did they do that? Well, let's talk about the title ascension ceremony, which I actually enjoyed because I didn't know what the hell this was. I didn't know what it meant. Okay, I'm like, title ascension. And then it wasn't until I saw the hook that I was like, oh, okay, they're about to raise the belt in the air. So they came out and the promos between these two guys were actually very good. So AJ Styles comes out. AJ Styles is talking and he says, you know, the last time, it may be the last time Drew McIntyre has the WWE championship. He said because he never wrestled Drew McIntyre before, he had to do his research on him. So he looked him up, and he found out it took him 19 years to finally become the WWE champion. And he says that, you know, he doesn't think that Drew McIntyre can handle the pressure. that, you know, that he's a, he basically called him a choke artist. He says, like, oh, you lost the title to Randy Orton. Like, yeah, you want it back, but, you know, I don't think you can handle the pressure. He says, you know, you've never even been in a TLC match before. Well, I have been in a TLC match, and I've won TLC matches. And, I mean, that's fine. They setting up, you know, hey, they never wrestled before. They're showing a little bit. But this is kind of stuff that, you know, Ring of Honor would put in, like, a little box next to the, like, that's something you would put, like, you know, the tail of the tape. You know, AJ Styles, how many years experience versus Drew McIntyre, how many years experience. You know, and then you would put, like, never been in a TLC match before, while you would put AJ Styles' TLC record up there. You know, like, it would be, that's that kind of stuff. As much as I like this segment, I didn't, like, that's not you telling me stuff like that. It's like, we could, you could do that in a different way. Like, why not use that kind of content on these stupid talk shows that you guys have, especially these pregame shows? Like, do like a tail of the tape on these pregame shows. Like, these shows are basically just guys sitting around talking about the match anyway. Tell, get some stats out there. Throw some, and I'm not a mark for stats either. Like, I know that there are some people out there that are complete marks for how many times they've wrestled each other, what their lifetime record against each other is, all that type of stuff. I don't need all that. It's interesting to know. It adds to the storytelling of the match sometimes. But, you know, I didn't need it in a 10-minute stand-up promo either. You know, like, if we're going to tell me that, it might be interesting. Just put it in a box somewhere. That if I wanted to see it, I could read it. If I didn't, I didn't need it. But I did like that AJ Styles basically said, hey, you know, you're a choke artist. You know, it take you almost 20 years to get to the top of the mountain. Didn't take him that long, but, you know, it took AJ Styles quite a while. But if you count, like, he was in WCW in 2001, I believe. So it took AJ Styles a long time. But, of course, Drew McIntyre didn't mention that. He basically just says that, hey, you want to know who I am. You wanted to research me. You should know me. He says that he's the guy who led WWE through these uncharted times in 2020. That he's a diamond. He doesn't crack under pressure. That he's willing to do whatever it takes to keep the title. That's good stuff. You know, obviously, scripted promo. You know, AJ Styles threw a line out there, which McIntyre was able to respond to. But I did like his response. You know, his response was, I'm the leader of the locker room. You know, I'm the guy that's here. I'm the guy doing it. You know, this is my realm. This is my thing. I'm going to do whatever it takes. I think that's cool. I think he would have responded that way anyway, you know? So that was fine. And then they played this dramatic Temple of Doom style music that they had. As the belt was raising in the air. I'm like, what? I was like, what the hell is that coming from? I thought maybe, like, I had tripped over something on my computer, you know, my phone or something, and there was, like, a commercial playing. I was like, where the hell that music comes from? And then I noticed it was on the TV. I'm like, what? Why is he playing this Indiana Jones style music on this TV? It was so weird. It was so weird. Anyway, as the dramatic music is playing, here comes Miz and Morrison. They come out of nowhere, hit Drew McIntyre. They push the ladder over, and Drew McIntyre gets hit in the face. Everybody jumps on Drew, and then Drew fights back because he can. He beats up everybody. He throws everybody all over the place. And then, you know, almost throws some stairs in the ring, which kind of distracted him, and AJ Styles took over. And then we get AJ Styles using all of the weapons. He hit him with a ladder a couple of times, hit him with a chair a couple of times, put an elbow drop through the table, and, you know, that's kind of how we go off the air. I didn't like that Styles used the weapons. I get that, you know, you want to establish the weapons, but at the same time, too much contact. It is too much contact. You know, there's something about the idea of these guys just fighting every single week. Like, I'll never forget that somebody, and I really want to remember who it was, they said that one of the keys to wrestling is that the more contact you have with your opponent, the more heat you blow off. That the people should pay to watch you fight. People should pay to watch you guys have contact with one another. And that, you know, the stare down is supposed to build the drama. Like, you look at some of these old wrestling promos, you know, especially from World Class, because that's really where the good camera stuff was from. Like, a World Class really sort of reinvented how wrestling was shot. It was very cinematic. There was a shot of Kerry Von Erich staring at Ric Flair, and it was from over Ric Flair's shoulder, and you could see Kerry staring at him. And you can't see Flair, obviously, because you're behind Flair. But you can see the intensity and the focus in the eyes of Kerry Von Erich. They did not make contact. But you can just look at them. And you can just feel the tension between the two of them just from that beautiful shot. WWE does that sometimes. But then there's times where they do stuff like this. They just have one guy beat up another guy. And it is kind of shot just like everything else, where it's constant camera cuts. And it's just like a distraction visual. And it's like, it takes something out of it. Like, I still feel that you have this first ever match between these two guys. They've never wrestled before. It does not need TLC. And they do not need to make that much contact. You could have built it up like, almost like a WrestleMania main event. Where you could have just had these two guys, you know, talking about one another. And staring each other down, but nobody makes any contact. Nobody hits anybody. We just go into the match knowing that there's going to be some wild friction, that these two had never wrestled each other before. Neither one of them has gotten the quote-unquote upper hand on the other one. And, you know, there's no AJ Styles got to get his heat back, or he got to get his heat before he loses. And then, you know, McIntyre can make the heroic comeback. We really didn't need that. You know, we really didn't need that. We really could just had these two guys staring at each other and, you know, building the heat, building the tension for the first time ever match. The first time ever really could have drew this thing. Where I'm at the point now, I believe I said it on Twitter, Fiend and Randy Orton should main event the show. And I know this is the first time ever. It's a TLC match. It's for the title. I get all the gimmicks. I get it. But as far as genuine interest in the match, I think people are more interested in Fiend and Orton. Even though I think that Fiend and Orton, the finish or the ending is far more academic. Like, I don't think people believe that Orton's going to beat the Fiend. But when it comes to intensity, and even though they've been having too much contact, you know, it just don't build anything on WWE properly. At least it doesn't feel like it. It all just feels like guys just constantly fighting, and they're looking for a reason to fight instead of having, you know, situations where, you know, tension can build and drama can build. And then you finally get the delayed gratification at the big show. Instead of having that, we just get guys fighting every single week, fighting the same guys, fighting each other every single week, arguing with each other every single week. It kills some of the excitement. You know, it kills some of the excitement. But let me know what you guys think in the comment section below. Like this video, share this video, subscribe to this channel. Thank you guys for listening. Help alternative wrestling media, because I saw some really bad takes from people who have a lot more money than we do. Sometimes, man, like, we really need help out here. We need to change the direction of wrestling media. We need more people who think, less people who emote, less fightful, more 3-count commentaries. Thank you guys, and I'll talk to you guys later.